This is the As Colorado As It Gets podcast, a weekly show brought to you by Colorado's The Great Outdoors RV. From how-tos to tips and tricks and RV news from some of the industry's top representatives, we're talking all things outdoors, the RV lifestyle, and how to live adventurously.
You ready?
Let's go.
Good morning, everybody.
Good
how
morning.
You guys doing?
Good
we got
morning.
Becca in the house, Matt Brown, General Manager, Tara Brossman. We are all here today. Very excited. We wanted to talk a little bit today about obviously a touchy subject in terms of how much this industry has changed because of how much our world has changed in the last year.
Sure.
But there's a lot of things that, you know, we've thought about, you know, from Matt going to his convention a couple of weeks ago to us just having conversation every day here at the dealership as to why it really does help for us to be campers in this kind of day and age. So we wanted to talk a little bit about that today. So Matt, why don't you start us off with, we've had some questions that we've got in from YouTube and all sorts of stuff that we wanted to bring up.
Well, and I think before we go there, let's give them kind of a heads up. We're going to cover a couple topics. So you want to hang in there because you know, some of you may not be super interested in what COVID's doing to the industry, but we want to talk about kind of briefly kind of what's going on with the mask mandates as it relates to federal parks, national parks, those kind of things. Because there's a lot of conversation out there around that. It's kind of a touchy topic, but we'll give you
that's what we're here for, though, is just to let you know what the conversation is. So
and
that
then
you're
the
informed.
Other thing that we've got out of response to some of your phone calls, our emails, just the inquiries lately is, hey, talk to us about some of your favorite your places to go. So I think we'll end on that note and kind of give you guys our take on where we like to go camping, how we like to camp.
We're not giving you the treasure map in terms of where our favorite spots are.
It was funny because we'll start talking about it and we're all afraid to give them up.
Right?
You know, because, man, we know how hard they are to get into.
Tara and I start looking at each other like, oh, my goodness, how many people can
actually plan years ahead. We don't need that to be 2 years ahead, you know. So, yeah. So let's start out by talking about COVID. And, you know, the RV industry certainly has been affected, just like every other, you know, industry out there. You know, we've all felt it. We've all dealt with it.
What a crazy year.
What a crazy year. And, you know, we've all watched people we love deal with the very real kinds of, you know, what it is.
Yep.
So we all get that it's
real. It's relevant.
It's happening. And I think, wow, you know, I mean, I remember prior to March last year, you know, how things were feeling and how the industry was doing. And typically that's the time of year we're getting ready for a big summer season.
Yeah. It's coming up.
And then March came.
Yeah.
And, you know, March happened and, you know, it was initially this screeching halt. You know, I remember watching the news channels just like everybody else with all the guys in spacesuits and the fear was real. You could feel it. And I think, you know, the RV industry, you know, in every kind of event like this, right, of this magnitude in history, there's always certain industries that come out forever changed, maybe some would argue for the worse. And there's some that come out that are forever changed.
For the better.
Arguably for the better, right?
And
in this opportunity, I mean, my heart goes out to people that own restaurants.
Right.
And you know, event small venues business. And movie
small
theaters.
And
small business across this country that have been impacted by this. It's unreal.
Yeah.
I'm here to say we are a small business. Mm-hmm. We're very proud to be one of the largest locally owned, you know, independently owned RV dealers in the state.
Yep.
We're Colorado owned and we're proud of that, right? Yep. But I'll tell you, this industry has seen and frankly benefited from an incredible uptick in business, if we're being honest, related to, you know, people's kind of immediate responses to something they can't control.
Yep.
Right. And you think about people who a year ago were planning cruises and vacations on, you know, islands and that involved you getting on an airplane and going to a hotel. And a lot of people today are saying, wow. Am I going to take that risk or not?
Yeah.
And you know what? The RV industry advocates for everyone because we want a healthy economy for everyone. So it's not as if we relish in the demise of an airline industry or hotel, you know.
Not at all.
Not at all. I think, you know.
I think it comes down to, like, you know, we change the way everyone kind of thinks about it. It's not just for fun anymore. You know, we understand that there's a dire necessity to make your living situation, whether it is more affordable or more pertainable to what you're actually doing. You know, it's we've recognized ever since March how much people have changed their lifestyles.
Well,
and
let's
I
be
think
honest,
that's what it comes down
you know,
to.
People still have a desire to control what they can control.
Right.
Yeah.
Because the uncontrollable is what's scary. right? And so the reality is, we've all been told to stay at home as much as we can, to do all the right things, you know, to protect ourselves, our loved ones, others. And so immediately the airline industry, the hotel industry, they all feel the impact of that because people feel somewhat, you know, reticent to do that, to make that move. Mm-hmm. But let's be honest, the mental health component of being cooped up at home, I mean, they're talking about that more and more now. It's right. Hard. A year into this practically, and the mental health, the rate of depression,
it's a real thing.
It's real. It's affecting people because they don't know how to deal with a context where for so long you isolate.
Yep.
And so,
or you have less control over your life. You know, that's
I can only speak
a
as a person,
parent.
as a parent, as a father,
yes.
You know, as a husband, and say, I know how much of my mental health comes from moments, the memories that are being created, and times to, you know, we all give a lot to the work that we do. So when you can get off grid and you can go away with your family, and you can, those times, whether it's on an airplane, you know, in a hotel or in an RV, are invaluable. And
yep.
So what we've seen come out of this, and I, you know, I'll tell you, I'm not unique in this. You know, I changed the RV that I had for the way that I wanted to use it.
Yep.
Because I wanted to use it more.
Yeah. That's right? The big thing.
I wanted to be able to get outside within, you know, we've just got this incredible luxury of being, you know, an hour to, you know, two or three from
the middle
here.
Of nowhere.
In the middle of nowhere with my family, still feel like I'm controlling the environment I'm in.
Right.
And at least just out in the, you know, the fresh air.
Right.
Yeah.
Making those memories. And some will say that's controversial. I don't think it needs to be. You know, it may not be for everybody, but to those
who do it responsibly,
you're still
trying to make those memories.
I don't think there's anything controversial about it at all. You know, I think the mental health component of this is real.
Mm-hmm.
I think that that's probably been only recently are we starting to acknowledge the impact of being a year down the road and telling people don't do anything.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, and so you have a couple of facts that come out of a year of COVID as it relates to the RV industry. Record sales, all-time record sales,
mm-hmm.
In pretty much every aspect of the business, in pretty much every product line, whether you're talking anything from Class A, you know, diesel pushers to, you know,
everything.
Travel trailers to pop-ups. It's there's almost no aspect of the industry that I'm aware of that hasn't been affected in an extreme way as far as total
growth.
You know, total demand, right?
Extremely high demand.
You see a huge emergence now, I think, of record first time RV ownership.
Yep.
And so out of that becomes even more of maybe a delineation in the two types of campers,
mm-hmm.
because you have a lot of people who for the first time in their lives are having, you know, maybe they used to be tent campers, maybe they've never camped. Becca, right?
Yeah.
The Bears and by episode 15, right. Here we go.
you're not going to forget that are you?
That's going to be a fun
one. We're not
one,
forgetting.
So we are not forgetting. She's trying to forget.
She's trying to forget.
We're only in episode 4. No, 3, I guess.
It's going to be here. But so you see people that are first-time RV owners and they're going, how do I want to camp? Am I that off-grid camper or am I the campground camper? And we talked a little bit over the first couple episodes about that,
right.
that delineation, but I think that's kind of coming more and more to a head,
yeah.
Right? There's just such a different way people will use their RVs. And that's creating new products. It's creating a demand for more campgrounds, a demand for more options, right? Because there's, man, if you have land right now and you don't know what to do with it, developing a campground is going to be a great return on investment in most cases.
For sure.
There is a shortage nationally of options. When we get to talking about our favorite campgrounds, places that we go, places to camp.
Yep.
How far ahead of time do you have to?
I mean, in some of those cases, it's a full year out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of mine I'll share with you today, I book it for the next year. While I'm there for this year, because otherwise, and so I'm only going to share it with you today because I've already made my reservation.
Right,
I'm good for this summer.
So you don't got to worry about it.
But that's the way it works, right? The demand is that real. what else has changed? Full timing, right?
Yep.
Inevitably, more full timers than ever before. There's mm-hmm. over 500,000 in the country that full time. But then you've got moms and dads and kids all, you know, working remote, doing school remote. So there are more people likely to be on the roads.
Never before.
But never were there before,
summer and spring break. And
yep.
Because why not? right? We live in a virtual world now as a byproduct of COVID.
Right.
I think it's interesting.
And I think, go ahead.
It's all good. So I was thinking, it's just like, it's interesting because it all comes down to the fact that it's not what we would typically have thought as the industry of RVers. Not like when I was a kid, it was my dad and my grandparents would take us up to Ossipee. We'd stay in the camper for a couple of weeks and that's right. It, you know, but.
And you could pull up that day.
Yeah. And we'd be good and totally fine. Yeah. But nowadays, it's, you know, the reason why we're talking about this is because the industry is evolving based on the fact that the world has changed completely in the last year. There's a lot more reasons to go camping and not spend the money that you were going to spend in the Bahamas anymore. Now it's, we want more control over our vacation. We still want to make memories. We don't want to be cooped up at home, but we want to be able to be safe. So this industry is a great opportunity for folks that are trying to think about stuff like that. So it's a relevant conversation, as touchy as it may be for a lot of folks. It's relevant because you're going to learn a lot about products that are coming out, like Matt was mentioning, that have developed because the fact that we have more people full-timing or more people utilizing that camper to take their kid on a real life field trip to talk about maybe the Grand Canyon or something. Mm-hmm. Those things are now going to be way more popular to do.
Plus, I think the age difference of people that are wanting to go camping. Like, there's a lot more of the younger generation that wants to do it as well too. Like, I think about my friends or my family members that are, you know, around my age, which I'm not going to say on recording, but
you weren't even born when I graduated high school.
Right. Okay. We'll go with that. I don't know what year did you graduate in high school? but I just
back in the 90s.
Oh, I was born in the 90s.
Okay, so like I said,
yeah. just too easy. But I do think that makes a difference too. Like, you know, people, even college kids, are they're still wanting to have that socialization or having that ability to go do something with the group of people that they're living with anyway. So I think that it's just changing. It's not so much necessarily just the retired or the families. There's a lot more of that younger,
which was just unheard of even when I was a kid, you know, and I'm kind of right in between you guys. Even, you know, late 80s, early 90s, mm-hmm. there was nothing of anything but families, and you didn't see younger people unless they were with somebody else. It wasn't even something to be desired. Agreed. As a younger person at
the
time.
The other thing that we see, right, that maybe is in something that wasn't anticipated, mm-hmm. right, is all these people go camping for the first time. Only then can they, in the second time and the third time, they start to realize. We talked about in episode one that, you know, people want to be connected. People want, you know, to experience those modern amenities and conveniences. And while that is important, I think on the flip side is the reality that there are so many people who are discovering that the way they used to travel kind of only perpetrated the life they lived.
Yeah.
Right. And I think there is a certain segment, and I think it's pretty large actually, that are discovering how stress relieving this lifestyle can be, and the world, we're all in such a hurry, we're all so connected that for some they've really discovered this outlet mm-hmm. to plug into for a period of time that actually allows life to become more clear.
It's interesting because I think about, you know, picturing that day where you have to get ready for the trip to go on the flight to the Bahamas, how stressful.
I was going to say, do you want to go to the Bahamas?
I ain't ever going to
the Bahamas.
I'll get sunburned.
I love the Bahamas.
Listen, though, it's
every time
comparable, though, like when you're talking about how much stress you have going into it.
The same thing, yeah.
Oh, whatever.
I ain't going to the Bahamas.
If I'm going anywhere, it's the mountains. I don't even have thought to go to the Bahamas.
If you're watching this podcast, we love you too.
We absolutely love
I do
you.
Think
we
are for that's all a good people. Point. Oh yeah. Because when I think about I've never gone camping, so I've never. But we've gotten family vacations, or like we've driven mm-hmm. livestock trailer, all like different shows and things like that. But it is that day that you're leaving, or that travel day or two that you have to go to get to the location. That's stressful.
Right. Yeah, my husband calls it "Don't Talk to Mom Day."
Right. Well, because that's hilarious. You think about that too, and then
that
you're
is
in
so
an RV.
Funny.
Yeah, that's part of the vacation. Yeah. You know, from pulling out of your house till the destination, that's all part of it. You can pull over wherever along. You know, let's stop at this location. You know, like
and
it
like,
just makes
and like Matt says,
camping has shown a new group of people what it means to be back out on the road again. Right. Just taking America in.
Right.
It's just once you realize how easy it is.
When airline travel was cheap and easy and not scary, you know, the Bahamas was at your fingertips.
The Bahamas were at your fingertips.
And as things have changed, you know, I think it's introducing people to spend more time in a car on their way somewhere, just a journey.
Right.
Just taking the scenery in. And so I think there's all kinds of places that COVID has taken this industry that maybe some will last forever as far as lingering effects, and maybe some will be short-lived. But, you know, I see the emergence of a small market product. There's a lot of new cool stuff coming out there for that person that wants to get off-grid, because so many people that are first-time campers are saying that's the way they would like to do it if they're going to do it.
For sure.
Well, and I think back to your point, you know, it's not always about, you know, it's not at all about us sitting here in a room and saying, oh, well, this is a great, you know, great thing. But it is an opportunity that's come out of something unfortunate.
I was going to say the same thing.
To be able to, you know, see the light in it. And and what else are you going to do? I mean, you have to, see the light somewhere. And
like you said, the people that don't want to be connected, but because of all the products that are coming out, somebody that like me that wants to stay connected is not afraid of going camping because you have that option. So it's not like, oh, I am only turning my phone off for an hour on the airplane. You know, it's like you have that the whole time.
You know, we understand.
Right.
Yeah. You know, I mean, kids, you need some form of, you take technology away for more than about an hour, they start twitching.
So. Twitching. I
mean, they're bored.
You know, that is so
the reality is, you know, in order to enjoy your trip, at some level, technology will be involved, because killing it all together.
Agreed. Just
takes the energy.
The I Spy game's not super fun anymore.
Yeah. Yellow car. See, I remember that.
That's funny. That's really funny to me, though, because I grew up, you know, the way I grew up, my dad, if I said I'm bored, he said be bored. Yeah. And so, you know, I told my husband about that, and he loved that one. And so that's, you know, where we are.
Yeah.
If we, you know, we don't take any technology anywhere. Mm-hmm. And good maybe for the you cameras, guys. That's about it.
Right.
Okay. But anyway.
All right. I'm the bad dad.
No, not at all. But you also camp. Right. You also camp in a very different way than I do. And we'll get into that, which is pretty.
I want to go camping
really
with him.
Yeah, it's really interesting.
Sorry, Tara, but I'm going with
that style.
We're starting to talk about our favorite places to camp and how we camp there.
Yeah, everybody will understand how different we really are.
How this room is divided. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm more for the clamp.
So, you know, I think the other pieces of COVID that I would say just be mindful of.
Well, come a little closer to the mic there, Matt.
Yeah, I think as far as the other two pieces we want to not lose sight of, record demand produces this record market. I was out in Indiana probably 10 weeks or 12 weeks ago, and I'm telling you, there was just fields of RVs that were missing a random part here, a random part there. That's all that was preventing it from shipping to a dealer somewhere. So there's product coming. They're trying to get caught up as fast as they can. But, you know, we're sitting here in February looking at a camping season that in Colorado tends to start in
March,
April, right, depending on what the weather's doing. Okay. Yeah. If you want to be that first time camper, brand new unit camper this year, you're thinking about making a move. I speak for the entire industry when I say make that move quickly. Get on a waiting list in some cases for the product you want. Yep. Let you know, we're more than happy to help you however we can. We've got waiting lists on product just like everyone else.
And now's a good opportunity to think about like this too, because you go into an RV dealership and you've got the products on the lot, but if they don't have the color tone you like or the seats that you like, you have an option.
You have a little bit of time. A little bit.
It's a good point
too.
Honestly,
just a little bit. If you want to use it this year. And the other thing is right now, we have probably about as high of a level of inventory as we're gonna have through summer. Right. So if you wanna be able to pick from a selection today and leave with something quickly that fits your needs, you need to get out and make that move quick.
Yeah.
The other side of it that I just want to speak to, and it's I don't believe ever in blaming something on something. I think that's bad customer service to say you can expect poor service because of COVID.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
That's certainly not what I'm trying to say here. I just want to put out there that when you're hearing your service center tell you that the reality of COVID is that window that they're trying to get for you, or that air conditioner they're trying to get for you, or that random plastic part that you go, I mean, what the heck, you know, is taking 2 months or 3 months. They're not making that up.
No, a reality is a reality.
That is an absolute byproduct of the COVID world and its effects on the manufacturing.
I was going to say, you see that everywhere. I mean, you go to the grocery store and your orange juice isn't there like you like it to.
But people kind of fail to make that connection.
Right.
They think that they're just getting an excuse from their dealership.
For sure.
And all of the camping forums I belong to, I see them saying that. and they want to believe that they're just getting crappy service from their dealership.
It's a very good point.
You know, the reality is when you have production facilities that once upon a time used to have everybody standing shoulder to shoulder manufacture something.
Same, yeah. Right.
And now they're being told, oh, you got to be 6 feet apart.
Yep.
This is completely, they rethink how to do that, right? So there are real, you know,
legitimate effects.
Yeah. Be gentle to your dealer.
Please.
Right?
And if you need service, get it in for service now.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Don't wait until you're, you know, a week or two before you're ready to use it.
And understand if they're busy, because there's a lot of folks right now understanding this reality.
I'm just so concerned for people that I know have a summer full of desires for camping.
Yeah, seriously.
That aren't thinking about the urgency of getting their unit in and getting it attended to now and getting that on record, because it's just going to be more important than ever. All right. So next we want to talk about another maybe controversial topic a little bit. Again, I don't know why it's so controversial, but it is. Is this mask mandate that the Biden administration has put out and how it relates to parks and camping? And Tara, you want to talk about this a little bit?
Yeah. So it has been, you know, said federal land that includes campgrounds for the most part.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, you know, RV Lifestyle actually put out a podcast on this the other day, and I wanted to touch on it as well here because they were saying some really interesting things. You know, what it boils down to is there's still a lot of confusion. We're still not 100% sure what's going on.
And mind you, this isn't our opinion or anything. We're just informing you as to what we've looked
up. This is what I know.
Yeah.
And what I know is, you know, that it pretty much states, you know, CDC guidelines.
Right.
And CDC guidelines say to, you know, obviously wear a mask when you're not with people in your own household, or should is the word, not must.
Right.
To still stay a safe distance away. What that means, I think, for campgrounds themselves, I mean, you're not anywhere near anybody else, even in a campground.
That's the point of a camping, right?
Exactly. Being in your own house, you know, with people in your own household, chances are everything's fine. But I think it's important for everybody to check local rules,
right.
You know, wherever you are, to make sure that, you know, you're
ahead of time.
And I think the reality is, right, some of you would prefer to be out camping, wearing them, because that's what feels right for you. And
exactly.
Some of you, you know, are going to go camping and say, last thing I want to do while I'm camping is have to wear these things. So
right.
You just got to know where you're headed. I think, you know, RV Lifestyle made a lot of the word should instead of must being used regarding wearing masks in national parks.
Yep.
So what it says is and I'm going to quote them kind of directly here. It says, should all wear mask, not must. Yeah. You know, so that's kind of the hang up, I guess. If you read the CDC quote exactly, it says mask may not be necessary when you are outside by yourself, away from others, or with other people who live in your household. However, some localities may have mask mandates while out in public. Please check for the rules in your locality.
Agreed.
Yeah, and that's the biggest thing, is everywhere in the country is going to be different, and everyone has to make their own decisions nowadays. So it's just important to stay informed as you're making a decision to go camping, you know,
right.
Look it up.
Making a decision to go camping, you know, where are you going to go? What's going to be the best thing for your family? What's going to be the best thing for you and for everyone else? You know, chances are, if you are someone who, you know, does absolutely prefer to wear a mask out, and no matter where
you
are in public spaces,
then
you're not going to want to go to a campsite that, you know, has very close together spots.
Right.
You're going to want to go somewhere a little bit more out of the way, and, you know, a little more.
So looking at the website and stuff before you're going camping is probably the best way to do it. Is you look at the website and see what the campground looks like, and everyone just has to make their own decisions based on this type of camping you're going to get into.
Make an informed one.
Our point being is just, you know, if you're going to go, just look it up, because it's something that is relevant. It's currently changing every other day, honestly.
And we'll obviously touch on this a little more once we have a little bit more information, because right now we don't have much.
Right.
And, you know, this hasn't even taken effect now, but it would be interesting to see, you know, what other people are kind of preparing for, and what your thoughts are.
Definitely. Well, maybe we do a poll, you know. I think, you know, shout out to RV Lifestyle, you know, as far as the podcast.
Yeah, this was a great podcast.
Yeah. Make sure to follow them. You know, but the reality is maybe we'll do a poll of our those that watch our podcast, and kind of how you feel. If you call in, you want to let us know through email. Mm-hmm. You know, are you the kind of person that when you camp would prefer to be masked up or not? Be kind of interesting just to know kind of, how, you know, I think country's pretty evenly divided on most things right now.
Yep.
And I think that masks are probably.
And would you be willing to trade your camp spots for, you know,
one or the other.
Yeah,
one
are you inclined to not go somewhere mm-hmm. or go somewhere because based of the on mandate. Their stance right. on yeah. that mandate?
Right. Yeah, that's a big one,
as
too.
As we head into another summer here. Yeah, interesting. Yeah.
Oh, that's a good thought to think
if we,
about.
If we get any you know any information we can share with you, we'll be sure Absolutely. To do that. Okay. So let's move on to the fun part of this, man. Enough about COVID and masks and all of those things. Gets a little depressing, man. There's so
Where
much
can
out
you
there.
Go camping?
There is so much out there that's to be had, and the summer's right in front of us. I'll shamelessly plug for two campsites that when you buy from us. We send you down the road equipped to use.
Yep.
There's one company called Midwest Outdoor Resorts. And one, I think they have three different properties, I think. But the one that I've actually been to, Rushmore Shadows, we actually give you up to 7 nights of camping with them.
Mm-hmm.
Three resorts to choose from. And you have 12 months to use it when you purchase from us. So that's just a byproduct of being our customer.
And you've been there.
I've been there. And we're talking about maybe that's where Becca will end up. We'll see.
Better be a nice one.
Bear Country is right next door. It's right, you know, about 6 miles, 7 miles, something like that from Mount Rushmore.
Yeah.
Right at the base, kind of as you head into the hills there. It's beautiful. The setting is beautiful.
Talk about that that wildlife refuge too, because that was something cool. You came back and you were super excited the stories you have with the kids there.
Like a,
it's fun. It's cool.
It's like a, a zoo on steroids. You know, it's
you just like drive through it, right?
You stay in your car, you drive through, and every different section they have different wild animals. You know, that because obviously can't all interact with each other.
Right. Yep.
So you drive through, and here's the lions. You drive through, here's the, you know, here's the bears, and they're feeding the bears, and the bears are just running all around your truck. And
yeah, I was gonna say they're out on the road.
We should share some video with them from just my own trip.
Definitely.
It was pretty cool. My kids, I like the bears. Favorite part of the trip.
Yeah,
the bears, you know? Videos you had where the guy, the truck was like,
I mean, the bears are jumping up in the back of the truck. I mean, you can't make this stuff up. And you know, literally, they say don't roll down your windows, but just a heads up, everybody rolls down their windows to catch the pictures, and I did too. Don't do that at home, I guess, is what we're supposed to say.
My dad was panicking that one of the bears was going to scratch the side of his car. Like, don't touch the car.
That's what I would be caring about.
They're right there. Yeah. Like, they walk behind your car. And
That sounds like a lot of fun.
It is fun. It's really cool.
So it's right next to Rushmore Shadows. And Rushmore Shadows is about 6 miles up into Mount Rushmore itself.
Yep.
So much to see out there. So much to do out there. I highly recommend it.
What's the name of that campground again?
This campground is a part of Midwest Outdoor Resorts.
Yep.
If you go to their website, it's Rushmore Shadows. Okay. I believe they have one more in South Dakota and one more somewhere else. That's the closest one for our customers that they tend to end up at. And you know, you got Mount Rushmore right there. So there's just a lot to make a trip out of.
Now that campground itself, is it more of a family oriented kids? Where do you
normally? I would say it's a pretty even split just from my observation while I was there. It appeared that, you know, there was a good mix of, you know, full time kind of retired folks there and also families.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the campsites are fairly spaced out. All pull through campsites, I think, from what I saw. So nice big spaces. Depending on the part of it the park you can get into, there's a portion that has a lot more trees than another. So you know if that's important to you, you know, ask about that when you're making your reservation. But great people, super friendly. It's just a neat part of the country to get out and see. Really, really beautiful.
Yeah, I've never been over there too. Cause like when I had the perception of Mount Rushmore, I thought it would be just Mount Rushmore.
No.
But then you came back with all these stories of all the stuff around it.
Yeah. There's little towns with just all kinds of shopping.
They have very, very good turquoise jewelry.
Yeah, Custer. Shout out to Custer because it's an awesome little town right as you roll in there.
Yep.
And that's a really cool place
to be. There's a couple cool places right there. You know, drive up to Sturgis while you're already out there and see what Sturgis has to offer. You know, they're all very different little places. And then Custer State Park. If you're already out there, you got to make a day of that. And it's super, super beautiful. And heads up, if you own an RV, I highly recommend you think about it before you haul your RV into Custer State Park. They have a lot of tunnels in and out of there that are one lane. They merge two lanes in. Both directions of traffic into one lane
to get through the tunnel,
and the tunnels are very, very short.
So do your research.
There are ways you can safely get an RV into Custer State Park, but don't just assume that right where you're coming from Mount Rushmore into Custer State Park. It's beautiful, breathtaking, but you go through a couple of those tunnels quickly. If you had a trailer behind you, you'd be in big trouble. you take the top of it off. So don't do
that's
that.
That's a side note to think about too when you guys are thinking about your trips in the future.
Yeah.
Look at the routes you're going to plan on taking.
Yeah, absolutely. And we'll talk about that. There's some great apps out there for putting in the height of your RV to plan your trip. That's definitely something to consider. But you want to get into Custer State Park while you're out there because that's where the buffalo run. Ooh. And they just run all around you and you feel the ground moving. And
that
it's
I haven't seen. I would love to see
it's
that.
It's a kind of a
feeling
a
the
really
ground
cool
moving.
Thing.
That must be so
you
cool.
Do. I mean, these things are so massive. And when they start running, you literally just feel the ground. That's moving. Cool. So we give you that. That's an and I think it's a great my family's had a great time.
Yep.
I highly recommend that. If you're in Colorado, you can get up there in about 5 hours, I think, something that's like that. It's not far.
That's not bad at
and
all
it's,
either.
It's easy driving with an RV. As you come up through Wyoming and getting in and out of there, it's fairly flat up until you get into, and it's still even
not bad.
It's not comparable to the Colorado mountains. So
right.
It's not a hard trip at all. The next one that we will plug here is Blue Mesa. And that's down, it's to the south of Gunnison.
Yeah, it's
and
like
we give you
Southwest Colorado.
5 days, 4 nights there. Another beautiful part of the country. You know,
I
if
love
you haven't
Blue Mesa.
Seen it.
I've been to Blue Mesa a couple of times and I love that area.
You know,
there's so many little lakes and stuff. I mean, you don't think of Colorado as being a state that has a ton of lakes, but you go over to Blue Mesa and it's like you're in a whole nother world.
Yeah.
You've got lake after lake,
yep.
All your own private area to check out. Great for ATV riding and dirt biking. So if you're into toy haulers, perfect little area for you.
Cool. Yeah. So we give you those two. So those are ones that we're partial to.
Right.
Let's start out. Let's talk about your favorites.
Goodness. Tara, you go first. What's your favorite area to camp in?
Well, I prefer being nowhere near a campground.
Okay.
You know, I like it. I like being up by Walden.
Yeah. So boondocking out in Walden.
Becca, you can plug your ears.
I'm coming. I'm going with him. I'm not going.
So, I mean, but that's, again, same thing. Best thing about an RV. You know, you go up there, you have bathroom, you have water, you have everything that you need.
Right.
And you don't, you know, you just feel like you're in a tiny home. But there's nobody around, which I love. Yeah. Some service, not really much, you know, enough to get my fix when I'm taking.
Yeah, if you know where you're going, you'll find service.
But we, you know, Michael and I, this is the best part. Michael and I really like to get lost. Matt likes his campgrounds. So we are kind of split here and we can give, you know, a lot of insight into both kinds of camping.
Right.
I would say if we're talking about Walden, Seymour is probably my favorite.
Seymour Reservoir.
Lots of ATV action going on up there.
So what,
also,
what's access like? How far off out of the middle of nowhere are you going?
It's off the path. Which
the pictures are beautiful, by the way.
Thank you.
Yeah,
yeah. If you're talking about going in between, it's right in between Steamboat and Walden.
Mm-hmm.
So and you're about 20-30 minutes off the main road on dirt.
Yeah.
Up in the middle of nowhere.
What are the roads like?
I mean, they're dirt. They're pretty rough dirt.
Getting there isn't too bad. I mean,
RVs in there all the time. We get RVs in, so it's not, you know, it is RV accessible.
In fact, most of the camping out in that area is mainly toy haulers, mm-hmm. big RVs, you know, because people want to go. If you're going
to
go out there, you're going
to
want your comfortability.
Yeah. Okay. I would also say another favorite of mine is right by a little ghost town called Teller City. You can go and walk up into Teller City, see the town and, you know, the ruins in the town, and they have little markers and everything telling people what it is, and it's kind of just wide open area. There's no bathroom accessibility or anything. So again, we are talking RVing. If you're interested in even having a bathroom, it's not in the woods, but yeah, just
where's that
big
at?
Fields and kind of same place, right over the mountain from Gould. If you're coming off of the canyon, off of out of the Poudre Canyon, and going down into Gould, we actually, there's two ways to get there. You can go all the way around Walden and like you're going up to Seymour.
Which is what
you can
had
find
to do
all this
during
on
the fires and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. Which is what we had to do during the fires. We actually had to go down the Silverthorn and then all the,
Silverthorn, and all the way back up at that point in time
because the canyon was closed at the time.
Sure.
We're talking about when the fires were going on here in Colorado.
Or if you like more off-roading, and that probably, you know, the cool thing about that is if you are ATVing or you are, you know, pulling a Geo with a Jeep, you can go and sit the Geo down and take the Jeep up over the hill and you're right back into Gold.
Cool.
So we'll take the Jeep and literally go over the mountain.
Took it in.
It's a lot of fun.
Cool. Okay. It's an adventure. That's for
it's
sure.
It's an adventure.
So that's where Tara's going.
That's where Tara's going.
So I've got a couple interesting ones. Yeah, three different spots in the country. One out where I'm from. One right here in the state. And one out in Utah. Okay. So the one out here in Colorado is called Mount Massive Wilderness. There's a lot of camping out there. Hundreds. I'm not worried about it at all putting this one on the podcast because there are hundreds of spots. But you go out to Leadville, Colorado, which is the tallest unincorporated city in America, which is really cool. You know, if you're bringing your kids out there and you're telling them, hey, you're in the tallest city in America, you know, they already think it's the coolest thing in the world. But you go on the Mount Massive Wilderness, you're right under the tallest mountain in the state, second tallest in the connecting United States, mm-hmm. Mount Elbert. And then you're also under the second tallest, which is Mount Massive. So you're in the most vast alpine area that you could possibly be in the state. So it's mm-hmm. really cool. That's, you know, really cool. You go out there and you've never seen anything like it. So I think that's by far my favorite area to camp. Okay. And I spent a lot of time out there. Okay. Second favorite area, New Hampshire. So we're talking middle of New Hampshire. It's called Russell Pond Campgrounds. Now, this is a very, very cool spot.
We'll put links to all of this in our YouTube, yeah. maybe, so that yep. you guys can see what we're talking about.
Definitely.
Write them down real quick.
Definitely. So Russell Pond is one of those campgrounds where you can't even book online. Like, you got to go show up. Okay. You got to pay at the gate, and mm-hmm. you get your own spot. But it's a very secluded campground on one of the cleanest ecosystems in the entire country of water. So it's a little pond. They have a beautiful beach for the kids to play on and go swim. You can literally go swimming in this pond, be in the middle of the lake, look straight down 30 feet and see the bottom of the wow. of the pond. So wow. it's really cool. Kids love it because it's a smaller pond too, so you can just go out in the middle of the pond and be swimming out in the middle of the lake and not have to worry about your parents yelling for you. So it's a good little area, easy to pull in and out of, all paved too. So if you go and you want to camp there, it's all paved road, so you don't got to worry about going too far off the beaten path there. But it's one of my favorites because it's very secluded, it's quiet, and it's just very beautiful too. So it's, you're talking middle of New Hampshire in the middle of the woods, especially if you go out there in the fall. Oh my goodness. It's like something you've never seen. So the third place I got to tell you guys about is over in Bryce Canyon. So that's this is in Utah, yep. middle of, like, when I went out here, I was on a road trip with Hannah at the time, my girlfriend, and we showed up, and I'm used to New Hampshire camping where every campsite is its own campsite. Right. And you've got a little bit of trees in between you. Oh my goodness. So I pull up to this site and it's literally just a giant, like, circle of RVs and tents, everything, just everyone all in one giant area. But where it's cool because you're in the middle of the desert. Mm-hmm. Like, it's at nighttime, you're seeing the full Milky Way, you're seeing every constellation, everything. You just look up and you're in the middle of like a snow globe. So it's really interesting.
Yeah.
So, but it was different for us because, you know, we're showing up and you're camping right next to people. I remember we were trying to catch the road early that next morning, and I set my alarm for 4:30 in the morning. Mm-hmm. So I get in my car to, you know, I'm sitting there trying to warm up because you're in the middle of the desert. It does get cold out there at night. I'm sitting in my car. It's 4:30 in the morning and I didn't realize that I locked the door. I open up the door and I'm still getting to know, like, the truck I was in there. I open up the door and as soon as I do, the car alarm goes off. I didn't know how to shut it off.
Oh, man.
It was 4:30 in the morning. And this is a campground like I've never experienced. You got everyone's right next to you. I remember there was a family of five right in front of my truck, uh-huh. like right in front of where the horn
is. This is the what not to do.
Yeah, right? Don't do this, please. This is, oh my God, it was so embarrassing. So I couldn't figure out how to shut it off. So I had to just get in the truck, start driving out of the campground. And I'm like sitting in the middle of the street trying to just like turn it on, turn it off, fix it. It took me like 15 minutes to shut off this beeping horn. I was in the back of the campground too. But either way, Bryce Canyon.
The moral of the story.
Bryce Canyon.
Your car, this is the guy who everyone in Bryce Canyon can't stand.
Yeah, right. I can't go
all
back there.
All those negative reviews, right? Those one-star reviews that
those
Bryce
were because
gave
of
the guy.
Him.
Lo siento.
That's Michael. Michael did it all.
But Bryce Canyon is a really, really cool spot.
It's just the topography is beautiful.
It's so interesting.
You haven't been through this.
Is that kind of up toward Moab?
Rock formations.
Yep.
And, okay. Yeah, so it, you know, you really get a different perspective of topography. I mean, coming from Colorado into the, you know, or coming from Vegas into there, whatever, however you get
no matter
there,
where you're coming from, it's so different.
A lot of red rock and real rounded formations. It's really neat. It's really neat.
So where would be the number, you know, the first place you would want to go? Like, first thing that pops into your head, first place
anywhere
you would
in the country.
Like, anywhere in the country.
You.
Well, any of you.
Oh, I was going to say.
Anywhere in the country.
I'm curious about what you would think. So if anywhere in the country, like, did you have an imagination as a kid? Like, I want to go to the Grand Canyon someday.
No, I've been to the Grand Canyon.
Okay.
I think Yellowstone would be cool.
Yeah.
Yellowstone?
It would be cool. Yeah. And actually, Yellowstone, I don't know the exact number, but that's the number one place that people are going through every year, I think.
Yeah.
Yes.
They have, I think it's like 250,000 campers a year.
Oh, it's crazy.
Right around in there.
So for me, having just returned from a trip to Florida, I put definitely Key West on the bucket
list.
I want to drive my fifth wheel down to Key West. I love the ocean. You know, we live by the mountains, and I'm blessed to have it out the back door, and I love being in the mountains, but I'm an ocean guy.
Yep,
so
me too.
I dream of the day that my family and I can sit with the back of the trailer up against the ocean.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would be
It's funny. I was actually going
to. That's on my list for sure.
That's okay. I didn't hear nothing on
technical
that.
Technical difficulties.
I was going to say Key West, so I will say, well, I'll take that off and say Redwood. I'd love to go to.
Yep.
You know, that's interesting.
Down to Sequoia. I've been,
beautiful.
And, yeah.
I've never seen it.
I would
the
love
The trees
to.
Are, I mean, so big. You can drive.
Yeah. I want to mention that because you were telling me I should probably talk about this. I lived out there for a little bit.
Yeah.
I lived right about 15 minutes north of Redwood Forest in a camper. Yeah. I lived in a 23-foot camper with Hannah for about 6 months.
And
they still like each other.
She's still with me. Yeah, so it wasn't that bad.
They survived.
That area is beautiful. Yeah. Redwoods is phenomenal. The Russian River, if you go north and you're driving up Highway 1 there, beautiful area. And by far, one of the best places in the country to take an RV. Because if you're driving an RV down Highway 1, oh my goodness.
Well, I mean, you can talk about Monterey. You can talk about... You know, I mean, there's California does have, and I grew up in Oregon, so
yeah, you know,
that whole West Coast, there is so much to see. And again, you know, the topography and the landscape changes so much from Southern California to Northern California as you come into Oregon.
Yep.
And then even as you get into Washington, right, what happens up the coastline completely changes.
It's crazy.
Cannon Beach is probably one of my favorite places I've ever been in my whole life. And Astoria, that whole area is just
Do you guys
so
want to
cool.
hear another crazy story? I've never been to the beach either.
You've what? Never been to
oh
the-
my gosh.
Have you, Becca?
What?
Okay.
We're gonna work on expanding Becca's horizons over the coming years here.
Expanding Becca's horizons.
We used to, when I was in Oregon, we used to go to Rockaway Beach, which is actually where Goonies is filmed.
Yeah.
No way.
Don't realize that.
That's one of my favorite movies.
But I'll tell you, one of my top three is Beverly Beach State Park in Newport, Oregon. Oregon is known to have some of the best state parks in the country.
Really?
And they're just you're instantly wherever you go, their state parks are well maintained. They're so lush with trees that you could be right next to somebody, not know you're next to somebody. Right. Outside of COVID, they're known for having amphitheaters where they do movies in the evening and things like that. So check out, for sure, Beverly Beach State Park. It's in Newport, Oregon.
Yep.
So not far, from Cannon Beach. And you literally are on one side of the highway. I'm camping down in this little ravine, and on the other side of the highway is the ocean. So you can literally walk under the highway and be on the beach.
That's really cool.
But you're like, it's dense with trees and just beautiful. And grew up going there as a kid. There's always pretty equal balance of tent campers and RVers. It's just a really, really cool place.
Oregon's one of those places I've always wanted to see myself.
Well, by the way, you just said it. I can tell we got to work on you a little bit. What'd you call it?
Oregon.
Okay.
Oregon. Okay. What is it? How do you actually pronounce it?
Oregon.
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 Like Oregon? That doesn't make any sense.
It sounds a heck of a lot better than what you said.
Oregon. So when she says it sounds about the same, but I have to convince her. We don't call Oklahoma Oklahoma, okay? So, you know, we do the wash, not the wash, okay? So
that's pretty funny.
My next one is Wallowa Lake State Park, which is in St. Joseph, Oregon. It's actually the Swiss Alps of the U.S. is what they call it.
Really?
So the mountains come right down to a big, huge lake. It's where Chief Joseph said, "I'll fight no more forever." And his final hurrah, right, is right there. So there's a little town with all these cool shops. But the lake and the mountains around it are breathtakingly beautiful. And they look kind of like the Swiss Alps. And a couple of highlights there are that they have a, what do you call it, that takes you up the mountain?
Gondola.
A gondola that takes you up to the top of the mountains. If you're in that sort of thing, and the view from there is breathtaking. The deer will actually come and eat out of your hands. Cool. The deer and the elk and... They'll come. You're not supposed to feed them, but everybody does, and that's why they do it.
You're doing all the things that you're not supposed
to
do.
Said it twice now.
It's a fun place, and it's absolutely worth the visit. You really go back in. Reservations are always booked out, probably a full year ahead in most cases. And again, that's another Oregon State Park. There's other private parks around there. The Oregon State Park is the one you want to go to. You can launch your boat right there into the lake. Beautiful place. The next one for me is more of a traditional like campground, private campground. Just went there this last summer in Heber City, which is up kind of out of, you know, Park City.
Mm-hmm. So Utah.
Not far from Salt Lake. Yep. Okay. And it's called Mountain Valley RV Resort. This place is spectacular. It is a resort. They have a adults only section for those campers that don't want to interact with kids. So they've got their own pool, their own amenities. Cool. Yep. And then there's a separate part that's all for kids and amazing pool and hot tub. And they did things in the park every night. They brought food trucks in and they had like movies in the park. So you
could go there.
Yeah. Really a cool place. And you're right near Park City and all that has to offer. But Heber City is a really neat little town. My last one is Colorado because I got to plug Colorado.
Absolutely.
And this one, good luck. If you want to camp there, check it out. Get on the waiting list at least a full year out. I make my reservations for it when I'm there.
It's like, just one of those campgrounds.
They only
it's
have like eight or nine spots for RVs on the water. But Ooh. You literally back your RV up. And this is it's Harry. If you've never... it's an experience. They will guide you into your spot. And without them guiding you, you're going to wonder how the heck you ever got it in there. I have a 36-foot fifth wheel. And every time I land it in this thing, I'm like, how did that just happen? Because you literally drop down this hill and there's the guy waiting right there to move you in. And he's got, like I said, 6 to 8 spots on the river. And they only have a couple other spots total. So it's maybe less than 10 spots. And then they have little cabins interspersed around there. But it is your back end of your RV will literally hang over the river. It is...
And can you imagine
it's
that?
Up in Estes Park. It's called Paradise on the River. And it is exactly what they say. The people that run the place are amazing. So I'll plug them all day long. They're great people. It's a couple sisters, I think, and their spouses. And it's just a neat people that run the place. Every time I go up there, we have a phenomenal time. The elk and all of the animals, you know, coming right off the river. You can fish right there off the river.
Cool.
And it's tight. But it is worth it. It's really, really
yeah. Like you said though, like that's just an experience you would never get anywhere. I've never seen a campground in the entire country where you can back like part of your RV over the river.
Yeah, I mean,
imagine having like a toy hauler where you open
oh,
up
right,
the party
so you can
deck.
Pull down the yeah. party deck.
Yeah,
oh,
I mean, literally, God, the so last cool. 2 or 3 feet of my trailer hang over the river, yeah. depending on the spot they get me in.
Right.
And you book a full year out. It's not far from YMCA Camp of the Rockies. So there's yeah. all of that. That's right down the street, but then you can go of course into Estes Park. And if you've never been up to Estes Park,
beautiful.
It's one of my all time favorite places. Too. My wife and I just so many great memories up there. We love to take our kids.
Agreed.
Up there.
I think it's a place. Real, it is a unique experience, Estes, and going up through Rocky Mountain National Park. And
yeah.
That is Estes one thing I used to do. I went to Estes Park with my family every mm-hmm. single summer. It yep. was just stayed yeah. in a hotel. So yep. I have been to Estes Park.
Yeah, Ooh. And while you're up there, check out the Stanley Hotel.
I was
That's
just
what it's
say
known
that.
For.
Yeah.
Obviously, they have the whole, I think they still, I know it's under construction, but the whole basement has the, like the tribute stuff to The Shining, because that was filmed there.
I didn't
Most
know that. That is
that.
Really cool.
So...
And it's is it creepy? They
have Halloween sketchy. Parties. Well,
it's yeah,
yeah.
Have you seen the movie?
I have. They did a good job with it though.
There. It's
and
a lot
the
of
ghost
fun.
Hunting things. That is, they do
isn't
there,
that
so.
Place like actually haunted though?
Yes, they yes. say so.
They say so.
Well, yeah. There you go, guys.
Depends on what you believe.
If you don't
in
feel
there,
like RVing,
but, you know. Yeah.
Go get
they
yourself
also
scared.
Have really, really, really high slides. Do you have to hike up like 7 feet of?
Well, and then Estes Park is now adding in that. What's the thing where you can go and down the mountain in the little
oh,
you sit
yeah,
on the little
so it's
seat.
Like yeah I know
yeah,
what
that's
mountain.
Like
yeah,
a
roller coaster
big,
thing
huge,
but
it's
yeah,
like oh,
going
yeah,
down the hill
steamboat.
Like those are picking up steam in this country because I have one
but it is
like
that.
Bobsledding.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah something
yeah,
like that
basically bobsledding
yeah it's like the concrete slide
yeah so they're adding that now too so that's
I definitely think the I mean yeah
but you're right there going into Rocky Mountain
Park is one of the most beautiful places highest paved road in the country.
Trail Ridge Road.
Trail Ridge Road, yeah.
Right there at it.
Some I mean, of you will love it, some of you will hate
yeah.
it.
Some of you some
I
of you will.
I white knuckle it all the time.
If you've climbed Mount
beautiful.
Washington though
is,
in a
it
car,
is beautiful.
It's not as bad.
Beautiful.
If
it's
anybody
so
from New
it.
England has climbed Mount Washington, that's not as bad.
Well, so Estes Park is it's right there at the gateway to Rocky Mountain Park.
And it goes into Granby.
And if you go up and go over, you'll drop down into Grand Lake,
which is beautiful
yeah,
as well.
Another beautiful place. A lot of great camping up there as well.
I
but
love
you
Grand Lake.
Probably if you're going to go there to go camping, you wouldn't go that way. You'd probably come down I-70 and yeah. go that way around typically.
I've seen RVs typically. Up there though. You know
yeah, what's yeah I have to. I was oh when gosh. I get up there, man, those
they
guys are
nice
braver than I.
But they have yeah. a, they those have people a lot
going
of fun.
Over the top of the oh.
Good for them.
They have a lot of good fun. They do, you know, the snowmobile races in the winter and everybody right. brings up their toy haulers and that's a grand old time. They do the same thing.
They have some ice fishing tournaments up there too.
Ice fishing tournaments as well. They do a lot of stuff. But I mean, there's just so much, especially Northern Colorado, you know, you've got some campgrounds. I mean, sure, you got to go a little ways, but I mean, let's go back to not only Esses, but Carter, Horsetooth.
Right.
You know, mm-hmm. we have a lot of campgrounds around, right around us that are easily accessible.
Yeah.
Easy to get to in an RV, mm-hmm. easy to get to without an RV.
Right.
And just, I mean,
maybe we should nice
do what is interesting. Like I think KOA says several of their top campgrounds are Colorado based. Mm-hmm. There's one down just south of Colorado Springs.
Yep.
There's another one in Larkspur.
I get a kick out of KOA though. They always get with the land that they pick to build on. It's always some of the best land in
oh,
the
oh yeah, area. They
yeah.
do well.
Like every time I see one, they have a KOA everywhere. They have one right. in Fort Collins. Well, and it's on a nice area in Fort Collins.
Another one of my faves is the KOA in Albuquerque, New Mexico. We go down there for the balloon festival.
Oh,
you know,
yeah.
most people don't realize that's the most photographed event in the United States.
Yeah.
Really?
And it is. If you've never been, you got to go. You got to put that on your calendar. To hit that, it's a bucket list. You got to see it. You'll never be able to appreciate it until you experience it.
Right. Yeah.
It's just something like really magical when you wake up and the sky is just full
filled with air
of
balloons.
Hundreds and hundreds of balloons. Mm-hmm. And then at night you get to go when they light them all up and they do the glow at too. The field. And there's a great KOA there in Albuquerque on the east side of town that we stay at, and we always have a great time down there because it's a whole different, you know, great food in Albuquerque.
Right.
It's
good
a fun,
shopping there
yeah,
too.
It's really
good
yes.
shopping there too.
Becca knows
if anybody wants to know where
there.
To go shopping, let me know. I'm sure there's campgrounds close by.
You know what I think would be a good idea is if we did our next episode on like these apps that we're talking about. Because as we're going about this is something we should do a lot. I think we should talk about the campgrounds we're learning about.
Yeah.
Especially with how, like we talked about at the beginning of this episode, with everything changing, there's a lot of companies out there buying up land to try
oh, yeah.
to campgrounds.
Well, again,
like we talked
that's
about
that's where
before.
I like to go, but mm-hmm. to your guys's point, you know, and I get there's always like this, do you talk about it or not, because everyone wants to keep their favorite spots secret, but mm-hmm. you know, we want to point you in the direction of how you can go out there, and you can either get lost and truly get lost, because I get it.
Well, while that's the thing. If people are sitting here listening to me and they decide to come up there in the middle of the summer and go where I'm talking about, there's not going to be anybody up there but me. So say hi.
Hi.
If you see somebody there,
yeah, we would love it if we heard about your stories too. So if you do end up going to any of these campgrounds, you have a funny story like my car alarm story, let us know.
Or share with us your favorite campsites. Right. We'd love to talk about them or give you a venue to talk about them.
For sure.
And also, you know, hey, if anybody's got any feedback on where should head in Key West.
Yeah,
I'm putting that on the bucket list. I'm gonna. It'd be a
I've
heck
never
of a
heard
journey,
of anyone that wanted to go camping out there.
But really? I want to do it.
Never.
I really want to. I really want to take my RV and I want to make
it makes sense.
With it.
Like,
and
if you,
see, that would be so much fun because I mean, we did something similar, but we didn't have an RV at the time, and so you know, we rented a Jeep, went to Key West, drove the highway, had a blast. You know, stopped several different places, and then actually stayed in Key West and made a couple days out of it. But to actually be able to do that in an RV and take the time,
I've been
time,
to Key West
down,
before,
too,
but when
ton.
I see these pictures of these RVs right. just hanging over the ocean,
yeah,
that
I know,
I mean,
so
yeah, I can just imagine that looking super cool. So
yeah, well, shout out to Key West and the Bahamas, we love you,
right?
The Bahamas.
The Bahamas.
In spite of Mike, we love you.
I ain't
going
to no Bahamas. Yeah,
that
I think we
funny.
Should do this more often, though. Talk about some of these campgrounds that are opening up, and
definitely.
You know, as this
yeah.
industry's adjusting, talk about it.
You
want to
plug your
cool.
campground? Let us know. Call in, and we'll you know, tell us why people should check out your campground.
And we would love to go. That's another thing. We would love to. To
where
show
would you
up
like
and,
to send Becca?
Yeah, where do you want to send Becca?
We're
going to
take the show on the road and do some reviews ourselves. You know, those that are maybe more local based.
Yep.
We've talked about getting up into South Dakota ourselves, so you know, we understand there's so much of this country that we could share with you guys and.
Yep.
Kind of, I mean, we're lucky to live where we do, but there's great
sure.
stuff all over the place.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anything else
yes.
from you guys?
Make sure to follow us on all forms of social media.
Where would those
platforms.
Be?
TGORV Co.
Twitter, Instagram,
TikTok. Facebook, TikTok.
Okay.
And
LinkedIn
YouTube.
And YouTube, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
If you want to call in, you want to tell us what you're thinking, you want to tell us what we ought to be thinking, you want to tell us what we ought to be talking about, 970-313-4337. Ask for our podcast voicemail.
Yep.
Make sure you leave your information so we can pick a winner and start to
celebrate. Let us know if you want us to play it on air.
Yeah, absolutely. And
anybody who wants to send in anything to us, tgorv.com/podcast. We'll have all episodes up there as well. So you can listen from the website or from your favorite podcast
platform.
And
yeah, grab our YouTube channel. Make sure to like it. Follow us on Facebook. Follow us on the social media channel.
Tell your friends.
Tell your friends.
Have a good afternoon, everybody.
Awesome. Thanks.